next 2 weeks, we're wanting to take a journey. It's real interesting because when you hear the word prophecy or prophetic, at times it seems very mystical. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And the prophetic within the church is very misunderstood. So I felt like the Lord wanted me to challenge our church to get a different perspective. Now hear me. This morning, I want to actually create a case for the prophetic within the body of Christ. The prophetic within the church. Now hold on a second, because some of you already have your preconceived ideas. It's going to be weird. This is going to be all this, you know, crazy stuff, mumbo jumbo. Just hold on a second. Because I want us to realize, before we get into the text this morning, Paul, ministering to the church in Corinth, and the church in Corinth was experiencing a lot of things. They had a lot of issues. And Paul had a lot to write about to the church there in Corinth to deal with a lot of things. And one of the things he had to do is deal with spiritual pride. And to deal with a hyper-spirituality, if you want to call it, where they were doing spiritual things, not out of the context of the motive to bless or to love, but actually out of pride. So people could see them, and the motive was based upon pride. But what Paul sets forth is the picture, and I want you to just hear this, a picture of understanding the responsibility that we have to edify and to strengthen each other. That the true purpose of the prophetic within the church is not to prove someone's spirituality, that they hear from God better than you hear from God. It's actually to set a base that the prophetic within the church is to edify and to strengthen. As a matter of fact, Paul makes it very clear that there is a necessity for the prophetic within the church because of the role that the prophetic plays to edify, to strengthen, to comfort. And we're going to talk about that this morning. Are you guys ready to get into the Word? Let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 1. And, you know, before we do, can you guys help me pray? Minister Darren, the reason I was leading worship this morning, Pastor Harold's going to be leading worship tonight. I thank God he's given us some great worship leaders. Is Minister Darren's grandmother passed away this last weekend, and so I believe it was Friday evening or so, he had called me and said, hey man, I got to head out to the mainland. So he's there. How many of you guys will pray for Minister Darren? Come on, how many of you guys will pray for his family? Thank you so much, and would do that. But are you ready? 1 Corinthians chapter 14, starting with verse 1, and we'll take a look at this text there in your notes. You guys have your notes? Put them up there. Let me see. Everybody got notes? All right, good. You're going to want this. Starting with verse 1, pursue love. Everybody say love. Love. Now, can I just say this? Is starting off, Paul puts an emphasis on love. Why? Because if love is not the motive of your life, then you're going to go in the wrong direction. Love is what helps keep our motives on track. And if what we do, especially within the church, if what we do, what we say is not based out of love, if it's based out of pride, if it's based out of manipulation, if it's based out of selfish ambition, then we're going to get off track real quick. If the reason you do what you do is so that you can stand up and say, everybody look at me, look how spiritual I am, look how awesome I am, then you've got the wrong motive and you're off track. And so we need love as a base that keeps us on track for what God wants to do in the church and in our life. Amen? So he says, look, pursue love. And of course, he says that after chapter 13, which is the love chapter. And then he says this, desire spiritual gifts. Now, I want to stop there for a moment, because as we look at 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 4, let me read it for you guys. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For the profit of who? Not for your ego. The manifestation of the Holy Spirit is not for your ego to create a platform for you to go into the world and have a national television show and have everybody think you're awesome. Now, I'm not saying having a national television show is not good. I'm just saying it's not for your ego. The manifestation of the power of God through you is not for you. It's for others. Can I get an amen? Amen. All right, there you go. Thank you. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. Verse 8, for the one who is given to the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as who wills? As he wills. Now, but this is the interesting thing that Paul says. Even though there's a parallel that we see of what Paul's talking about, the spiritual gifts. Now, there's spiritual fruit. There's fruits of the Spirit. But there's also gifts of the Spirit that we function in and manifest from our life. We saw a list of that. Miracles, preaching, generosity, right? Speaking in tongues, interpretation of tongues. So there's wonderful gifts that we get to partake of within the Spirit. But what's interesting is Paul makes a phenomenal statement. Listen to this. He says, desire spiritual gifts. Meaning chase after. That's really what he's saying. He says, you need to long for these spiritual gifts to be made manifest in your life. And really he's saying, he didn't say just you're only allowed one spiritual gift. Only one per person, right? He's saying desire spiritual gifts. Each one of you, I'm stirred as I look upon this amazing congregation. I look at some people that have the gift of giving. And I'm like, oh man, they stir me up. Pastor Ann is one of the largest givers in the church. And I'm stirred by her. I'm just like, man, I want to be like Pastor Ann. And then you have these other people that they have a spirit of hospitality. Oh, you go to their house and you feel like you're royalty. I want that. I have a problem when people come to my house like, stop. Yeah, help yourself, man. Fridge is, you know, whatever. I don't do that. I'm joking. You know, and I see wonderful things. You see, like Benny Hinn, he flows in miracles and signs and wonders. It's awesome. And I desire those things. And Paul gives us permission to desire spiritual gifts. It needs to be something that in your Christian walk, you long for. But then he says this, but especially that you may, let's try that again as a group. I think I lost some of you guys. Especially that you may. Why? Now listen to this. This is why. Verse 2. We're going to fly through this. For he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God. For no one understands him. However, in the Spirit he speaks mysteries. So we understand right now that when we speak in tongues, tongues is not for the person standing next to you. Tongues is to what? Edify your spirit. You're speaking mysteries. It's to strengthen you. It's not to strengthen the body. And so that's why Paul's putting an emphasis. He says, he who speaks in tongues edifies himself. But he who prophesies edifies who? The church. He who prophesies edifies the church. I wish you all spoke with tongues. Now, if you just heard what Paul said, he did not demean or degrade tongues. One problem I do have is that we've come into a place within our modern day society of church that we think it's okay to degrade and dismiss and demean tongues. Nowhere in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, you can even go all the way to verse 36, does Paul ever at one time demean, dismiss, or degrade tongues. As a matter of fact, he tells us that it is a necessity in our growing and our relationship with the Holy Spirit. But he goes on, he says this, I wish you all spoke with tongues, but even more that you prophesied. For he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks with a tongue. He's not saying you're spiritually greater. He's talking about the position that you have to edify the church. And he says, unless indeed he interprets, that the church may receive edification. Let's all say it together. That the church may receive edification. Father, I pray that you anoint this word. I pray that you anoint our ears to hear, our hearts to receive. I want everybody to just stretch your hands out towards me. Come on, pray that God use me. Father, I pray, give me the words to say. Holy Spirit, I pray that you give me divine insight, that we can challenge your people. Lord, that they will leave this place changed by your power. In Jesus' mighty name. And everyone said, amen and amen. We're talking about prophecy this morning. And one thing I want to make sure we all understand is this, that we are all called to prophesy. Now hold on. I did not say we're all called to the position of the prophet. We're all called to prophesy. Well, how do I know that? Because Scripture says this.
In Acts chapter 2, verse 17, listen to this. It says this, "And it shall come to pass in the last days, said God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants, on my what? My manservants and my lady servants." Now, look, I know everybody has their opinion. Everybody has what they, in this church, we believe that God has anointed men and women. I believe, as a matter of fact, it's very hard for me at times because the best preacher, I personally, one of my favorite preachers on the planet is my wife. She's got to listen to me preach all the time. And we don't discriminate here. Because why? The Spirit of the Lord is upon men and women. A lot of the letters that many people take out of context, they did not take cultural context into consideration. But here we believe that the Spirit of God is upon men and women. But what I love is you say, I will pour out of my spirit in those days and they shall all prophesy. Why is that so important? We have to recognize the position that God has given us, that we were all called to be used as oracles, if you want to say, of the voice of the Lord to this generation, to this world, to the person sitting next to you. That's why in this church, some of you may think, why in the world do we join hands and pray for each other? Because God wants to use you to speak life into them. I'm not saying you have to look and say, thus saith the Lord Godeth Almightyeth from heaveneth aboveth. You don't have to do that, but God can use you to speak life. We have to acknowledge and we have to embrace the call of God to understand our position on earth to be mouthpieces for the voice of the Lord. I want to give you the definition of prophecy, and just for the sake of us having a deeper understanding, the Greek definition of prophecy, and some of you may have it there in your notes, prophetio, which means, number one, it's twofold, not T-O-T-W-O, it's twofold, all right? Number one, it is the definition of divine inspiration. When you look at that word prophecy that is used in 1 Corinthians 14, it's twofold, two meanings, okay? Divine inspiration. It means to prophesy, to be a prophet, speak forth by divine inspiration, to predict with the idea. Now, this is not the Webster's dictionary definition. This is the Greek. When we understand what Paul was saying, this is what he was saying. People understood it as such. To predict with idea, foretelling future events pertaining especially to the kingdom of God, to utter forth, declare a thing which can only be known by divine revelation. That is prophecy. It means you, in the last couple weeks, we've been dealing about prayer, dealing with prayer, dealing with the connection with God and how the devil attempts to sever that. It's having a connection with God that he can speak to you and through you. Isn't that awesome? Now, first of all, isn't it amazing that God actually wants to talk to you? He desires to speak to you. He has wisdom for you pertaining to your job, in your marriage, in your family. He wants to talk to you, but he also wants to talk through you. And you know, a lot of times we'll pray, Lord, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, but we're not willing to speak kingdom here on earth. We've got to learn how to declare the word of the Lord. But I want to talk Matthew chapter 16, verse 17. I want to talk about first the first idea of divine inspiration. Matthew chapter 16, verse 17 shares a story of when Jesus asked Peter or the disciples, who do men say that I am? And Peter said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus' response is so profound. He says, Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. In one moment, here's Peter, dude. Peter is strange. Peter's got issue. And in one moment, Peter learned how to speak God. He was so detached. Now, some of you may think that's a weird idea, but he was so detached from understanding the perfect will of God and hearing God. And in a moment, God reveals his plan and his purpose to Peter. And it's just like, boom, he learned how to speak God. And he began to reveal. He says, you are the Christ, the Son of God. Jesus says, flesh and blood has not revealed this. You know, I want to tell you something. How amazing is that? Because if you look at every person, you look at the person next to you, they have the potential to be able to speak God. They have the potential to hear God's voice and declare what God is saying. If Peter can do it, God speaks to us, and he speaks what? Look at the person. Help, you guys are like really tired this morning, or I'm just very, very boring. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. I want you to look at the person next to you and say, God wants to speak to you and through you. All right? There we go. John chapter 10, verse 27, Jesus himself says, my sheep hear my voice and they follow me. They know me. I love the story of Samuel, 1 Samuel chapter 3, where God is Samuel's a young man. God speaks to Samuel in the midnight hour, right? I'm telling you, those times where you should be sleeping, God woke up Samuel. Samuel had a direct connection to God. But you know, that's not for the super spiritual. And a lot of us, we're intimidated by it, aren't we? We're intimidated by the prophetic because we think we have to have this super spiritual experience. It's not. It's just God wanting to speak to you. And it's you being willing to listen and to hear and to answer the call of God. And that's probably the best thing Pastor Eli could teach Samuel, was how to respond to the calling of God. And if there's anything that I can accomplish in this church for you, it's how to hear the voice of the Lord and how to respond to what he's saying. How many of you guys want to know how to respond to what God is saying? I think it's important for us to also consider the source. In our life, we have to make sure that we consider the source. Where is what you are hearing coming from? When I was a little kid, there's this place called Eyal Valley. Anybody here ever been to Eyal Valley? So the water's at times, the water's really crisp and clean and nice, and it's just awesome. And so my friends and I, we were playing, and they have this tiny little like place you can jump off and have fun. And we're just little kids, and the aunties were all around, and we had this great idea. Let's spit water at each other. So, you know, we're doing the fountain, and we got a big old mouth full of water, like, because we were under the assumption the water was clean. It looked clean. And then one of the aunties is like, oh, boy, you cannot do that. I'm like, why, auntie, why? She goes, listen, upstream, there are pigs. And the pigs, they shishi and poo-poo in the water. That's what she told me. I'm like, yeah. You're like, oh, my gosh. We got to consider the source. What you are speaking, where does it come from? What you are speaking, where does it come from? Now let's talk about that, because let me just give you four sources that we see in our life. Number one, God. Now this is the one thing that we're able to do, is we have the ability to discern where these ideas, or where these voices, or whatever it may be that we hear, these words that we speak, where they come from. And we know it's God because, for one, God's intention is life. You speaking death is not of God. You speaking hopelessness, you speaking fear is not of God. That's not the word of the Lord. You casting judgment upon people is not the word of the Lord. The words of God build life. He said, I've come to bring life, and life more abundantly. So we understand that we can even discern and judge some of the words that we say, going, whoa, that wasn't God. How do you know? Because that just killed somebody. That was bad. That was not godly. That was all flesh, man. And the second one is we battle with emotions. Anybody in here battle with emotions? Now, I'll just tell you a little bit something about myself. I'm half Italian, and Italians are very passionate people. Passionate eaters. And why you gotta laugh for? And the other part of me is I'm Irish, Scottish, English, Dutch, German, everything crazy. And my mom, anybody here ever met my mom? My mom is fiery. She's got red hair. She's like, ah! You know, she's like, ah! And she's kind of, and I love her. She's awesome. She's passionate. But one thing that I battle with, maybe not you, but me, I battle with, is my emotions. And my emotions are deceiving. They get the best of me. I just, you get to the point where you get so emotional, you can't even control yourself. You're just out of control all over the place. And I realize that some of the things I say, the root of it is based upon how I feel and my emotions. But the worst part about that is because your emotions can be so deceiving, you can say something that's not true, say something that's not godly, and make a declaration based upon your emotions that will lead to destruction. And so we have to be careful that we don't allow our emotions to get the best of us, right? We have to learn how to discern what's the voice of God, what's our emotions. How about this one? Others. Everybody has their agenda. We got to learn how to discern. And I, you know, the story that so blessed my life, when I was about 30 years old, I became the site pastor of Maui, the Maui Cathedral. And I was reading a story about Solomon's son who became king. And he had this decision to make. Either he was going to heed the voice of Solomon's counselors, who were elders and they were much older, or he was going to heed the words of the next generation, guys that were all his age. And he had this decision to make. And the worst part about it is he chose to listen to his generation. There were a bunch of yes men. They had these other ideas, and he stopped listening. As a matter of fact, he told all the other counselors of his father to just get out of here. He dismissed them all. And the worst part that you see is that very decision led to him losing his kingdom. See, God's going to place godly people in your life that will give you godly wisdom, and that's something we have to seek after. As a matter of fact, Solomon tells us to seek after godly wisdom. But we also have to be aware there are people that aren't so wise. And normally the people that aren't so wise talk a lot. They got a lot to say. And sometimes it ain't always right. And you have to learn how to discern that, right? But lastly, the devil. The devil attempts to warp the truth. Attempts to use your mouth for death. I love this clip. This is like one of my favorite clips of anything and everything. It's so cool. It's one. Anybody remember Cusco? Right? The llama? Yes? Check out this clip. Check this clip out.
You're not just gonna let him die like that, are you?
My shoulder, Angel.
Don't listen to that guy. He's trying to lead you down the path of righteousness. I'm going to lead you down the path that rocks.
I'll come off it.
You come off it.
You.
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 You, Infinity. Listen up, big guy. I got three good reasons why you should just walk away. Number one, look at that guy. He's got that sissy stringy music thing.
We've been through this. It's a harp, and you know it.
All right. That's a harp, and that's a dress.
Robe.
Reason number two. Look what I can do.
But what does that have to do with him?
No, no. He's got a point.
Listen, you guys. You're sort of confusing me, so be gone. However I get rid of you guys.
That'll work.
You guys ever feel like that? Seriously? Like all the time? Whose voice are we going to listen to? We have to learn how to discern the voice of the Lord from all the other voices that we hear. Because the only way we can truly prophesy under divine inspiration is we have to learn how to hear God's voice and hear it clearly. You've got to make a decision in your heart to fight some of that stuff. You've got to make sure, you got to sit there and go, you know what, that's not from God. That is contrary to the word of God. That is contrary to what God thinks. That's contrary to what God would say, right? Now, the second part, as we were talking about prophecy and the true definition of prophecy, is we see it as inspiration, divine inspiration. But what's quite interesting about the definition that we receive from the word prophecy is that it's twofold. The second meaning, the second definition, is practical application. Listen to this. Under like prompting, meaning divine inspiration, to teach, refute, reprove, admonish, and comfort others. Listen to how practical that is. It's not this shaking that happens. You know, now I can prophesy, I'm shaking. Look, I love the prophetic, but I hate weirdness. I hate when the flesh just starts getting in the way and we make what God wants to do so fleshly to hype up our spiritual pride. Now, I'm not saying shaking, rattling, rolling is not of God. That's not what I'm saying. But what I am saying is this, that the prophetic is more practical than we make it out to be. As a matter of fact, the prophetic should be a common occurrence within our life and within the church. That's what Paul is saying. That's what Paul is saying. So we have to be aware of this, that it's more practical than we even understand. And we are the ones that have to make a choice. See, Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat of its fruit. You have a choice. You have to make a decision. The choice is ours. Will your words be used for life or for death? Because no one can control your words but you. Well, my husband, he made me say it. No, he didn't. The devil, he made me say it. Mm-mm. You're the only one that can control your words. What we say, we can't give credit to anyone else. That was our decision to let that come out of our mouth. No one can control your words but you. See, the devil understands the power of the tongue. He hears that verse. He knows what the tongue is capable of doing. So he attempts to shut you up. I want you to see this picture. Check that out. That's what the devil tries to do to us. He wants to shut you up with fear. He wants to make you think like, well, what I'm about to say is not important, or this isn't God, or, oh my goodness, I'm so intimidated, I'm so fearful. And he wants to shut you up because he knows if he can shut you up and keep you from declaring the will of God, he wins. Because some of you need to learn how to declare the purposes of God and the word of God over your marriage, over your body. And so what he will do is he'll try and shut you up so that you don't have the faith, so you're fearful to declare the will of God, to declare the word of God, to get a word from the Lord and say, you know what, Lord, you spoke to me that I'm going to live and not die. And then he puts people in our path, right, to try and discourage us. I like this one. He tries to use your tongue as a weapon of destruction. I want you to write this down. I think it's in your notes. It says speaking daggers. Anybody know somebody like that? I've met a few people like that. Come on. Oh, my goodness. He's like, do you have anything good to say? Like, seriously? You know, the worst part is I have a tendency to be like that. When I'm discouraged, when I'm frustrated, when I'm tired, when I'm hungry, I have a tendency to talk like that. See, that's the natural response of our flesh. And the devil knows that. So what he wants to do is he wants you to speak daggers. He wants you to speak words that are going to cut and they're going to hurt instead of give life. If you don't understand the power of your tongue. It's funny, the devil understands the power of your tongue, but most of us as Christians don't. We don't understand how much life can come from speaking forth and declaring God's purpose and God's will. This is how Paul helps us as we close. Are you ready? You guys still with me? We're almost done. Now, understanding the practical application of the prophetic. We see practical prophetic. The practical prophetic. What do you mean? Paul gives us three things that the prophetic is used for within the church. Now, let's first stop and understand something. Public prophecy is not for correction or rebuke. You know, we have over 700 people in this church, and we only have like 200 some odd people register for the prophetic conference. And trust me, it's not the cost. Some people are like, man, Pastor, I don't want to, I've talked to people, Pastor, I don't want to go to a prophetic conference. People will be calling out my mail, say, you whore of Babylon. I'm like, ah. Right? I'm like, oh my gosh. I mean, you stand up. Yeah, you right there. If that's what I thought, if that was my idea of a prophetic, I'd run away. But it's because we don't understand the biblical principle that Paul gives us of what the prophetic accomplishes and does within the church. Public prophecy, individual public prophecy. We're not talking about prophesying to a nation or a generation. We're talking about individual public prophecy. Someone has a word for you, and it's public. Paul says there's a basis by which we give out those words. And he gives us three things: edification, exhortation, and comfort. Now let's just break down those things real quick, because I think it's beyond just in the church. It's our personal lives. The word edification, the Greek definition, is the act of building up one who promotes another's growth in wisdom, holiness, and happiness. Have you ever been in that point in your life where you just hit a ceiling? You've been going along, you're like, man, this is awesome, I'm growing, and then all of a sudden just poof. And you just didn't know what to do, you didn't know where to go, you didn't know what steps to take. This is the wonderful thing about the prophetic. The prophetic has the ability to bring edification to your life that takes you out of that pit or that ceiling that you keep hitting, whether it be in your business, in your marriage, in your growth, your walk with God, and pull you out and say, hey, let's take a step up. God's got more for you. You may be discouraged right now. You may be frustrated where you are at your business or your job, but I want to give you hope. I want to help restore hope to you. There's another level that God wants to take you. Amen? But secondly, we also see the word exhortation. What does Paul mean by that? He says it's a communication, because now, let's not get this wrong. Edification is not just speaking, it's also walking. It's taking people. You can walk under prophetic exhortation by grabbing someone and taking them with you. Edification. Saying, you know what, you're stuck here. I'm going to come with you because I know what God's called you to. Let's walk through this thing. Right? How many of you guys need some people like that in your life? But exhortation is communication. That means declaring, using your words with intent to stir, excite, encourage one into action. One thing I love about this church, one of our founding verses is Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24. This is my job, to provoke one another to love and good works. There's times we get off track. In my personal life, in my spiritual life, probably every road that I'm on, there have been moments where I'm like off track. I'm in the weeds. And I've had people in my life that have prophesied, have declared the word of the Lord to get me back on track. Like what we talked about with guardrails, to help me realign. And that's what the prophetic word is for. It's not to throw out your dirty laundry and be like, oh, look at this person. It's the word of the Lord coming forth to help you get back on the right direction. And the wonderful thing about this is that it's a word of encouragement. It's meant to stir you up. It's meant to help you realize, you know what? God has called me. God has chosen me. I'm a pastor. I've been a pastor for 15 years. Probably not that long. Feels like longer. A long time. So long, I can't even count. Anyways, I've been a pastor a long time. And in my life, I've seen some moments where people just get so off track. And they have to hear the word of the Lord to bring them back. I long for that. Because there's moments even in this church, we've gotten off track. We get focused on this and that and that. We want to accomplish this. And you have a tendency to get off track. And then all of a sudden the word of the Lord comes. There have been moments in my life where all of a sudden the word of the Lord came. And I'm like, oh, Lord, that's it. That's what you've been. And it was confirmation. Now, listen to me. This is the difference, though. The prophetic is not for direction. A lot of people rely upon the prophetic to be for direction. The prophetic has nothing to do with direction. It has everything to do with confirmation. It confirms the word of the Lord in you. You do not take prophetic as direction. Never, ever have I ever taken direction from a prophetic word. Because then what it does is it takes my dependency off of God. I have to hear from the Lord. I've got to get a word from the Lord. But the power of the prophetic is that it helps confirm. Because sometimes I'll forget. Sometimes I'll get off track. But I get confirmed in the word that the Lord's given me. Amen? But lastly, to comfort. To give strength and hope. To ease the trouble of. I want to close this by sharing an interesting story. Just moved here to Oahu. I was discouraged, frustrated. I know none of you have ever been discouraged or frustrated before. Just me, I've got issues. I'm discouraged, frustrated. And the worst part about it is I was fasting. That's just, really? And so I'm super hungry, I'm tired, and I have a meeting at the Kahala Mall. And of course, I enter into the food court. And so God and I are having like this discussion, and we're like, you know, God, I'm frustrated. I'm here. This is not happening. Why are you allowing this stuff? I mean, this is just ridiculous. Come on, God, where's the breakthrough? And I'm having this battle back and forth with God. And the whole time I'm like, okay, God, fine. If you don't come through, I'm going to eat. What now? Mrs. Fields was right there. I was like, bring this. Bring it. And Cinnabon right there. I mean, come on, Jesus. Anyways, so I probably look like a weirdo because I'm in the food court and I'm going back and forth. I'm like headed toward the direction to get food. I'm like, no, I can't. Jesus, help me. And I'm like, no, you know what, Lord? Fine. I'm just going to eat. I don't care. This is not worth fast. If this is what fasting brings about, I'm done. I'm going to go eat. I'm just going back and forth, and all of a sudden, I couldn't see, I remember her from Adam. I don't remember her face. I don't remember anything. But all I know is I'm walking back and forth, and this lady comes. It was like a prophetic drive-by. I'm feeling like super hopeless. I'm feeling irritated. I got no faith. And this lady goes, God's pleased with you. And she keeps walking. She doesn't even be like, hi, my name is, and thus saith the Lordeth Almightyeth from heaveneth. She didn't take my hand. She didn't like lay hands on me like, She didn't like get her anointing oil that burns your forehead out of her purse. You'd have to experience just short story, bunny trail off to the side. There's this lady in our church growing up, man, she had this anointing oil, and she put some kind of stuff in it. And she'd pray, Pastor, let me pray for you. Oh, okay. And she'd get it on her finger and rub it on, and she's like, in Jesus' name, pop, and like a stamp, and it would burn. And you're like, is this the anointing? What am I supposed to do? And it was the perfume. It was like this oil. It was like, and then the worst part is you had a red thumbprint right there. Hi. It was none of that. It wasn't a show. It wasn't a spiritual pride. It was, and I'm not against anointing oil with perfume and stuff. And I'm not, just don't on my forehead. You know, it hurts. I'm not against that stuff, but I want you to understand how common, how practical the prophetic can be. Here I am. I'm in a pit, man. I'm hopeless. I'm faithless. And this woman walks by me. And all she says is, God's pleased with you. And she walked off. Didn't even know. Never met her before. And all of a sudden, chicken skin, faith began to rise up in my heart. Like, Lord, you hear me. Lord, you're here. You see, that is what Paul is saying. It's he's helping us remember that this thing is not about some spiritual position. It's about edifying the church. The place of the prophetic in the church is edification. And you know, this morning I want to take up a challenge. And I want to take up a challenge even in myself to do what Paul tells us to do. To be one that edifies, exhorts, and comforts. To allow the words of God. I want to be a mouthpiece of God to my wife. I want to be a mouthpiece of God to my children. I'm going to be a mouthpiece of God to my circumstance. To the sphere of people around me. Was at a dinner. Wasn't a Christian dinner. Wasn't a churchy dinner. It was just a bunch of business people together. And the whole night I'm sitting by this businessman. And inside it's just, God's just tearing me up. He's like, I got a word for him. I'm like, Lord, this isn't the right environment for this kind of stuff. Looking for my holy oil. Anyways. Afterwards, I found a place to come up to him. I shook his hand. I said, hey, you know, I want to ask you a real quick question. And I began to ask him just something. I said, you know, don't take this as being weird. And I want you to understand something. But I feel like God wants to help you. This guy's not a Christian. As a matter of fact, he's a Muslim. So I feel like God wants to help you. I felt like the Lord gave me a picture for you. And this is what's going on in your business. This is what's happening in your life. And I just want to let you know, if you give it to the Lord, he's going to help you. He's going to intervene. And he looks at me like this. He goes, wow, you're very perceptive. I'm like, what does that mean? And then after that, he began to tell me some of the things that was happening in his business. I'm like, wow, Lord, only you know. You can be God's mouthpiece. But you have to make the choice. Every head bowed, every eye closed. If you're here and you will take up the challenge to be God's mouthpiece, if you're here and you say, Pastor, I know I very easily can get caught up in my emotions, I can get caught up in all these other things, and there are times where I've hurt people with my words. But Pastor, I want to take on the challenge to let my mouth be a mouthpiece for the Lord. I want to declare God's will, God's purpose over my finances, over my life, over my family, over my children. And Pastor, I want to take on the challenge. This is real simple. It's just one call. I want to take on the challenge to prophesy. To live under divine inspiration and practical application. To be used to edify, exhort, and comfort. If that's you, you're willing to take that challenge. The count of three, will you just stand with me, all boldness? One, two, three. Now I realize something. I need a lot of help. Because I got a lot of flesh. I got a lot of fleshly tendencies, sinful tendencies. I think we all battle with that. I need God's help. And this morning, I want us all to just lift our hands. And can we ask God to help us? Help us to be one that edifies, exhorts, and comforts. That this church, you know what one of my greatest desires is? Not that this church is the coolest church in the world or has the greatest technology. My greatest desire is that when people come here, that which Paul said the church was supposed to experience, people walk in here and be edified, exhorted, and comforted. Father, this morning we pursue love. We ask that you help us. We need your Spirit to help us because this is one of the spiritual gifts that we get to partake of. Lord, we want to prophesy. We don't want to be bound by the things that are happening around us, the situations and circumstances. We don't want to be bound to the perception of our emotions or others. Lord, we want to declare your word over our situations. We want to declare your word over our marriage and over our children, over our finances, over our body. We want your will to be done. So Holy Spirit, we cry out to you, help us. We depend upon you. We rely upon you to help us, Father. To speak life. And we thank you, Father, for it now. In Jesus' name. If you're here, you say, Pastor, I don't know if I died today. if I'm on my way to heaven. And I know I need to make a decision for Jesus Christ. I know there are things in my life, Pastor, that aren't right. And I want to get those things right before Him. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you believe in your heart God raised Him from the dead, you shall be saved. If you know that today's the day to get your life right with Him, the count of three, will you just lift your hands so I can pray for you? Ready? One, two, three. You lift your hands. I see that hand. 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 Thank you, Lord. I want everybody here to say this prayer with me. And it's not the prayer that saves you. We're not saved by a prayer. We're saved by faith in Jesus Christ. This is just a tool to help you express your faith. But let's all say this together. Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Wash me clean. Purify my mind and my heart that I may serve you with everything that I have. Jesus, I believe that you died for me and that you are the risen Savior. Today, I make you Lord of my life. I give up control. I submit and I surrender my will to you. And Lord, I ask you, will you fill me with your Spirit? Fill me with your power. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Can we give Jesus some praise? Amen. Amen. How awesome God is. Were you guys encouraged this morning? I want every person here to just lift your hands to the Lord. I want to pray a blessing over you. And before we do, let me just give you one last challenge. Be used by God this week. Let your mouth be a mouthpiece of the living God. You might run into someone this week that needs some encouragement, and God's got something to say to you and through you. Amen? Father, I just pray an anointing upon every person in this church, that you bless them supernaturally, and they're coming and they're going. Lord, every part of their life shall flourish and prosper. And Lord, we ask for an anointing, God, to expand their territory. Lord, I ask that you speak to them clearly. Let their ears be open, Father. Let them hear your voice. Let them be guided by you this week, Father. Guide their steps by your Spirit. In Jesus' mighty name. And everyone said, amen and amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful Sunday afternoon.